So we've come on in a very important day because we got to see what happened on Palm Sunday as people walked in and were praising this king that was to come. And as we got to see that their shouts of joy and their shouts of praise quickly turned into the words of crucify. And we wondered why that was, and we got to see that it's when we don't get to see our expectations happen, we automatically turn on someone and we turn on these things and we automatically have that thing. But also on Friday, they took him to the cross where he said some words up there that made the difference for all of us. He said, "Tetelestai." It was finished. He paid for our sins on the cross. And we'll get to look at a little bit more about what that looks like in a second. How many of you guys like to go to the movies? You guys like to go to the movies, see the movies, watch movies? Who likes the Avengers series? And like these Marvel series, you guys like that? There's all kinds of crazy things out now. A lot of the old stuff that I used to watch, and these things were on comic books back in the day. So if you don't even know what a comic book is, it's like a book. It's paper that you looked at. And some were black and white. Some were colored. If you were special, you got the colored ones. But I remember watching all those types of movies back in the day. And I used to watch all these Marvel movies and get excited. There was some, back where I was from, there was some that were black and white still. Black and white TV. And I was the remote for my pops. Turn it to that channel. You know what I mean? That was the remote. But it's funny that I used to look back at those movies, of these Marvel movies, or even some of these ones that were cheesy. I look back and I look at the Godzilla movies. And I'm like, wow, those are cheesy movies. For us older ones, we can go back and look at them and they're just cheesy. I'm like, oh my gosh, we were watching that stuff, but we were all into it. In these movies, we're always looking towards this main event, though. We're always looking to see. There's usually a conquering of good and evil. We get to see it on both sides, right? We're always looking to see what's next on this scene, where the part where our character is going to be in this battle, and he's going to fight, and he's over there, and he's fighting, and all this big stuff is going on, and you're all in tune with it. You're like, oh my gosh, it's going to happen, and all of a sudden, your character dies. You weren't expecting that. How many of you have seen a movie and you're like, it's not supposed to end that way. It just didn't, that's not the way it's supposed to end. And that's what happens sometimes with those movies. Then all of a sudden, you see in those movies, what do you see? You see a finger move. And you see a hand. And then you get to see this guy get back up. And what does he do? He comes back and he whips all these people and he makes everything right, right? Well, let me tell you this morning, that's what happened today. That's what happened today. A couple of thousand years ago, Jesus came to set us, man, you and me, free and to whip death and sin. He says, we always say this, what did he set us free from? From hell, from damnation. That's what it is. It's a separation between us and God. That's what that saved. When people say saved, that's what we were saved from. And there's a literal place that it is. That's what saved is all about. But my superhero this morning, and hopefully you can come to see that, my superhero is Jesus Christ this morning. He's the one that came back to life. He's the one that conquered sin and death, and that's what I can rely on in my own life. So this Easter, what people would call Easter, is about the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's what Easter is about. You know, as many are sold into the idea of the Easter Bunny. The Easter Bunny, which is cute, it comes in many colors, and it comes in many calories, right? You guys know what a calorie means. You guys are always counting the calories. What? Let me see. Where's the label on these things? Who likes Peeps? There's so many different colors. There's different ones now. We even chocolate ones. You ought to try to put them in the microwave. Try it when you get home. Nah, I'm just kidding, because it'll blow up your microwave. It comes like a bomb, and then you're scrubbing on your microwave, so don't do that. But it's cool to be able to celebrate this time together. But as many try to hide it, this day is celebrating this death and resurrection of Jesus. It's about being crucified on the cross for the sins of the world, and him coming out of the grave 3 days later, because death couldn't hold him. It couldn't keep him in that grave. You know, I know that there's a lot of people that know this. A lot of people have seen the cross, right? But do we get what the purpose was of that? if he truly died, this Jesus, and came back to life, that's a pretty big deal, right? Because the dead, because when you're dead, dead is dead, unless you're on TV. Dead is dead. So if this is true, I must think about this for a little bit and really think about it. If this guy came back to life, there's something there. But as for you and I, as we come into this reality, if Jesus died and was resurrected, it changes everything. It does. Why does it change everything, Pastor? He conquered death, and he said for those who believe in him, when they die, they would be with him. They would too be resurrected. Not here, but with him in heaven. We'll look at that here in a second. Because here, I'm going to share a scripture with you out of John 11, 25. It says this. Jesus said, I am the resurrection, I am the life. Everyone who believes in me will have life, even if they die. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never really die. And he says to Martha as he's speaking to this, do you believe this? And that's a question for us this morning. Do we believe this, that he is the resurrection and the life, and he's come back to life? Do we believe this? Even if we die, we're going to come back with him. For some say, where am I going to spend my time with him? In heaven. Yes, that's where we're going to spend. Most people think that there's going to be this harp, and you're going to be sitting on this cloud. It's nothing like that. It's going to be crazy fun, and we're going to have a lot of fun there. As I was talking to an individual the other day, he says, do you think there's going to be fishing in heaven? I said, I'm sure there is. I said, I'm sure there's going to be all kinds of stuff. And he was excited. He was pumped up. He wanted to go then. And I'm like, chill out. Chill out. I said, you don't need no fishing licenses. You don't need anything there. Free bait. So he was hooked right away. Also in John 14, it says this, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am and where I go to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I'll come for you and get you so that you'll always be with me where I am, and you will know the way to where I'm going. You know, as I looked at this scripture, it was funny. It cracked me up in verse 5, this next verse here, because it shows our humanity. It shows Thomas here in his humanity, because he told him here, and you know the way to where I'm going. And he says, I don't. Where are you going? I don't know where the place that you're going. And that's awesome that he says that, because sometimes we don't get it either. So where are we going? Sometimes we think that we're going to get there. We know the way to get there. You know, I'm a registered voter. I'm going there. I've been good. I can get there. Sometimes we do that. But look at what Jesus says next. Dude, come on here. I'm going to show you the way. Dude, that's my emphasis. Jesus answered, said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The only way to the Father is through me. But what does that look like for us today? If he's the only way and the truth and the life, how do we get to the Father? That's the only way, it's saying. It doesn't say many. It says he's the only way. So all these other ways, do they come to a dead end? As I heard someone share recently that all roads lead to God. And I had to think about it for a second, say, do they all roads lead to God? They eventually do. Because when you die, you're going to have to stand in front of him. And you ultimately will see him. It says that every knee will bow and confess that he's Lord. So we know that we'll get there. But what does it look like in our lives? Our lives must change. There must be a change within us. In what way, though? I need to stop living for myself and living for him. Living according to his way, what he's called me to live. Because there's a lot of times that we live our own way and we think that that's right. But in the end up, going our own way, and we end up in a dead end sometimes. The Bible tells me when I live in my flesh, I can't please him. You know, this is a misconception of the day, that we're all pleasing to the Lord. No matter how we live, how we act, God is pleased with me. Remember, I gave the guy money on the street corner. You remember I was parked there and I gave him money. So that's my ticket into heaven. Here's also another misconception. I'm going to vote pro-choice. I'm going to cheat on my taxes. I'm going to take off after I get my girlfriend pregnant. The Lord's going to be pleased with me. Is that even logical? Is that pleasing? Do you think that's pleasing? Let me put it to you this way. Can you go to work every single day, do what you want to do, and your boss is pleased with you? I wish. I too have a company, and I wouldn't be happy about it. That's my point here. Not everything we do is pleasing to the Lord. Does He exist to tell us how good we are? No. He exists so He can tell you how much He loves you and how much He cares for you and how much more He's got for you than the life that we chose to live. That's what it is. He's given us so much more. And it reminds me, and I've shared this story with some, as my wife had a dream one night. And she said that she was in this deep sleep and the Lord came to her and she was in heaven. And it's her arrival, He stands there and He meets her and He gives her this hug. And He presents her with this beautiful little box, beautiful ornate box. And He says, go ahead, open it. So she opens it and looks inside. And there's a bunch of different things. And it wasn't like gold and silver. It was just like gifts of just something that He was giving. And she says, this is so beautiful. And He says, well, come on with me. Let's walk. So He walked up to this beautiful doorway and He opens up these doors. And as far as the eye could see was these gifts that was in the box. They were all over as far as the eye could see. And He told my wife, this is what I had for you, but this is all you settled for. We only settle for a little bit of what He's got because we want to do it our own way. In Romans 8:8, it tells us this. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. What is this flesh that we talk about, this flesh? Is it my skin that doesn't like God? Or what is? The Bible calls flesh, it's rebellion to God. The resistance to the things of God. We live as we're our own boss, doing what we want to do, and trying to add a little Jesus to it. That's living in the flesh. You know, in Matthew 6:33, it tells us, when Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount, he told the disciples this, and all the people who were listening, He says, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all the things that you need will be added to you. But today, it's seek God fourth, fifth. Let me get my life together. Let me get all this stuff together, and then let me see where I can add you in. It's like a recipe. Let me salt shake a little Jesus into my life and see how that works. That's living in the flesh. He says that those that live that way can't please Him. Again, here in Matthew 12:30, it says, anyone who isn't with me opposes me, and anyone who isn't working with me is actually working against me. That's striking, isn't it? How could I be working against God? The one that created everything. How can I be working against Him? It's not me. It's what He's saying here. I'm just repeating what He's saying. You can look it up for yourself. That should be alarming to all of us of what that means. This is where we get to see that good and evil battle within ourselves. When we have to choose over the things that He wants us to do and the things we want to do. It's that Superman kryptonite. You remember those scenes where they bring the kryptonite? It's like, oh my gosh. And that's the thing, is we come across that part of where we have to fight our flesh to do what He wants. Because it's pleasing to do what we want to do anytime we want to do it and all that stuff. We can do a lot of those things, but is it pleasing to Him? How do we do that according that way? Is He living in our lives? Is He first, as I said? When you're living for Jesus and He's in you, not yourself, it tells us in that next verse of Romans 9, verse 9, it says this, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you, if indeed that Spirit dwells in you, when you accept Christ, that Spirit starts to dwell in you. You're saying, I'm dying to myself today, and I want you to take over. That's what I want in my life now. But there's also a misconception in that. I've came to Jesus, I found Jesus, there's all this other stuff. Does that mean that I came up here and I accepted Christ, I'm perfect? Does that mean I'm perfect? No. That's where you get to see the grace and mercy that He's given us. This place, this church, is a place for hurting people, for broken people, not for the righteous, it says. We come here to hang on to one another, to trust Him. We're not perfect. He gave us, He paid for all of the mistakes that we've done. But He also says this, now if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he is not His. So you get to see a black and white there. Either you're for Him or against Him. He came so we could be free of that and to be free with Him this morning. Isaiah 61:1 says this, the Spirit of God, the Lord God, is on me. The Lord has chosen me to tell you the good news to the poor and to comfort those who are sad. He sent me to tell the captives and the prisoners that they have been set free. What have you been set free from? Sin and death. You know, sin, as I spoke, a little bit separates us from God. And He don't want to be a part of us when we're in our sins. We're slaves to it. I can look back on my life and say, I was a slave to alcohol. I was a slave to this. I was a slave to that. I was under its control. When they say you're under the influence, you're under the influence of that stuff. And we have to choose what influence we're going to be under, ourselves or under His. Jesus came to set us free from that slavery. But what do we do? What's our part in this? What do we do since He did His part? What's our part? John 8:31 says this, if you abide or you obey or you follow in my word, you will be my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth will what? Make you free. Do you want to be free? There's times in our lives that we don't know, we don't see the end of the tunnel. As we see, there's light at the end of the tunnel. Sometimes for me, it looks like there's a train coming through that tunnel. That's the only light that I've seen because of the stuff that I've done according to my own ways. I wanted to do all my ways and then add a little bit of Jesus, but then I came head on with that train and my life was disaster. Thankful for Him that He didn't give up on me. He says, I'm going to seek you out and I'm going to continue searching for you till you come out of that. And He's been faithful in that. As I spoke about in the beginning, the main event happened today for you and for me. As in life, there's some main events, but none as so powerful as this. You guys, some of you guys have kids, you guys have gotten married, there's some big main events in your lives, right? But this, by far, should be the most important in our lives because He came to rescue you and me. This is that one time that you were drowning on the boat and that buoy got thrown to you. That's your opportunity this morning to be saved. I was drowning in my sin. I was drowning. I could blow you away with what He's done in my own life. And I know some of you guys have similar stories of how He can take me where I was at and put me into where I need to be is great. He set my feet upon the rock, what it says, that I was no longer slipping off of it. This morning here, I'm not here to tell you how good you've been, how bad you've been, but how good He is of what He did in sacrificing. John 3:16, as many have heard this, tells us that God so loved the world. He loved us so much that He sent His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him would not perish, but have eternal life with Him in heaven. You know, He loved us enough to die for us. That's why He says when we see all the blood and say that's a bloody religion, it's that blood, it's through that sacrifice that He did that made us clean. That's what we got to understand. You know, but this thing that He did is not a gift. It's not something that we could earn. You know, a lot of us say, well, I helped all the old viejitas, and I helped over here, and I held many doors open, and I did all this stuff for people, and I volunteered there. That doesn't mean really nothing. He He said, the gift that I want to give you is free. He says in Ephesians 2:89, for by grace you have been saved through faith. It's not on your own doing. It's a gift from God, he says. Not a result of works. So none of you can boast about it. I did this. I did this for God. No, he did it for me. It's a one-way thing. Yet you get to see how great of love he had for us. Share another verse with you out of 1 Corinthians 15. It says, now brothers and sisters, that's both you and I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you have received, on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you are saved. But what is it? What's that next thing that he says there after saved? If you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. There's a lot of ifs in there. It's like here or there. He says, otherwise you have believed in vain. You're kidding yourself. If you're not following the ways that he's called you to live, you're fooling yourself. We're often plagued by so many choices in life of what we're going to make the choices of. We got a choice of coming here, not coming here. Going to this church, going to that church. We're plagued up to what meal we're going to eat. Even football teams. What team we are going to choose, right? Just yesterday, as I was reading through this and stuff, I'm walking into my bedroom and I open the door and I look and I see my dumbbells there. I see a curling bar and it's got weights on it. I'm like, I should hit that for a little bit. And then I looked over onto my nightstand and there was some peanut brittle. God. I didn't go to the weights. You guys are laughing because you know I didn't go to the weights. It was a choice that I had to make of what was most important to me at the time, and I guess that was most important. So I do blow it too and say, I know what was good for me, but that's where his grace and his mercy for you stands tall. You know, it's funny in a sense, but look at what verse 3 says of that 1 Corinthians 15. For what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance. This is the main event here, so don't miss this. That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. That he was buried and he raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. And that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. That's what he did for you and me today. That's the meaning of what we're meeting here today about. My prayer this morning is that you understand what really happened on this day. And that we would see the importance of following him. And I hope that that would be your choice this morning. That you could be made free, regardless of where you're at this morning, you could be made free. It's said in the book of Romans 5:8, that God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Even though he knew you were going to blow it, he still died on your behalf. He says, it's going to take a long time for this Leonard to get it together, so I'm going to stay with him, and I'm going to continue seeking him. As I didn't want to seek him, I sought my own way. Till I got to a place of my lowest place that all I had to look is up. I didn't have anywhere else to look. Several times I've blown it. He did this out of love for you and for me. What's even crazier about this? He sent what? What did it say? He sent his only what? His only begotten son. He only had one son. And he sent him to die on the cross because of you and for me. Let me ask you this. Would you send your kids for me? Would you send your kids for the people out there? The drunk, the addict, and all of the other people that are out there? Not even them. The pornographers, all the other people. Would you send your kid to die because of them? I'm sorry, I wouldn't. That's how great a love he has for you and for me. To send his son to be nailed on a cross to take on something that you and I couldn't pay. Because it says the wages of sin, what our paycheck for sin is death. When we continue to add those up, it's spiritual death at the end. That's that separation between him and us. And it's a place called hell where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth, and that's somewhere we don't want to be. As you gaze upon the cross, just think of what he endured for you and for me. He said, "Forgive them, Father. They don't know what they're doing," even as they nailed him to the cross. But he held on. He could have given up. But he loved you that much that he spread and he said, "It's finished." But just a word of warning for all of you guys this morning. Don't get in the trap of being stuck on Saturday. Why do I say that? Without the resurrection of Christ, we would be in dire straits. If Christ had never been raised, our faith is futile and we're still in our sins. You remember the disciples had scattered. They were freaked out of what happened after he had been crucified. They were running away. They were freaked out because they thought they were going to be in the same place. They spent Saturday hiding in fear of being arrested. The day between Christ's crucifixion and his resurrection would have been a time of grief, shock, as the stunned disciples tried to understand the murder of Jesus and the betrayal of Judas and the dashing of their hopes. Sometimes you and I get stuck in Saturday because Friday he died for us and we don't know what happened after that. But today he is risen and Sunday is today. Don't get stuck in Saturday anymore. He's out of that grave, as we've already sang. But I stand here this morning, family, to tell you that he's alive and he's risen. And death could not hold him any longer. Amen? Amen. Amen. He says, "For those who put their faith and trust in him, they will be with him when they pass from this life." When you live for Christ, you're no longer accused or identified of who you used to be. Sometimes we wear those labels I talked about a couple of weeks ago. We wear these labels that, "Oh, I'm just this, and I'm just this." No, you're not. You're a new creation in Christ. That's what you are. He's our hope. We're children of the King now. When we see this picture of baptism, this new creation in Christ, it means that we're going down the old man, that he can be drowned, that the Lord raises us back as a new person. All of that residue of this world and all the stuff that we've done, those pieces that we were identified have been washed away. We're new creations in Christ now. The Word of God should transform us and change us into looking like who He is. Nobody loves me like you love me.